Over 65% of the world's desalination water capacity is in the Gulf. In the UAE, the Jebel Ali Power and Desalination Complex recently expanded to 2.2 million cubic meters of total desalted water capacity per day. That is more than 880 Olympic-sized swimming pools every day. Over in Saudi Arabia, there is the Ras Al Khair Desalination Complex, a power and water cogeneration plant. Built for over $7 billion, it can produce 1 million cubic meters of fresh water each day. The monstrous scale of this freshwater production fascinates me, but the more I read about it, the more I feel like they should not exist. In this video, I want to look at it. The countries of the Gulf Cooperation Council, or GCC, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, the United Arab Emirates, Qatar, Bahrain, and Oman, are some of the most water-stressed in the world. The region has suffered from water scarcity basically since human memory. Kuwait, the UAE, Saudi Arabia, and Qatar have less than 100 cubic meters of renewable fresh water per person. To compare, the average household of four uses about 136 cubic meters of fresh water each year. And what little surface water these countries do have might not be drinkable. For instance, the water in Saudi Arabia's largest surface lake, Al Asfar, largely comes from agricultural runoff, so much of it is contaminated with heavy metals. In such situations, people drill for groundwater, but groundwater exploitation in the GCC countries is already quite intense. Continued extraction has negative social consequences like land subsidence, and only about 10% of groundwater extracted is recharged. Moreover, these countries' populations are rapidly rising, doubling from 26.2 million in 1995 to 56.4 million in 2021, which is roughly equivalent to the Chinese province of Hebei. Births are slowing down right now, but fertility rates are still higher than in Japan or China. Moreover, the GCC is one of the most urbanized places in the world. 85% of the population resides in an urban city, and that is expected to further rise in the future. With that, water demand is on the rise, including from agriculture. Farming of cereals, vegetables, fruits, and fodder for animals consumes up to 85% of the GCC countries' water resources. National security-linked self-sufficiency food requirements make it difficult to get around this. Considering these challenges, the GCC countries see desalination as the best way to produce enough renewable fresh water. Jeddah is a large city in Saudi Arabia. It has long been a gateway and travel hub for travelers going to Mecca, making it very densely packed. The city gets less than 10 centimeters of rain every year, but does border the salty Red Sea. The city had long drawn water from two springs about 50 plus kilometers away, but with the population booming, the city purchased a desalination machine from the United Kingdom in 1907, the first ever in the area. This machine, locally named the Kandasa after condenser, produced fresh water by evaporating and recondensing seawater. It loyally served the area for nearly 20 years before being replaced with two new plants in 1928 with the same name. The 1920s marked many of the first land-based industrial desalination plants, including a big one on the country island of Curaçao in the southern Caribbean seas. This upsurge in global desalination capacity in the 1920s and 1930s was driven by the booming oil industry. But it was World War II that really pushed the industry forward, with the United States the technology leader. After the war, the Middle East nations, including those in the GCC, were the first to explore this technology for their water-starved people. In 1957, Kuwait installed the first modern-style distillation plant by Westinghouse, capable of making about 3,800 cubic meters of fresh water per day. Later in 1966, Saudi Arabia established a dedicated water desalination office within the Ministry of Culture and Water. It was led by the Prince Muhammad Al-Faisal, son of King Faisal. Al-Faisal made a previous appearance on this channel as the prince who was promised a feasibility study on towing icebergs from the Antarctic to Mecca. The idea didn't quite work, but I admire his ambition and creativity. This office later became the Saline Water Conversion Corporation and was recently renamed to the Saudi Water Authority. Today, it is single-handedly responsible for 22% of the world's desalination capacity. Starting in the second half of the 1970s, desalinated water capacity in the Middle East, North Africa countries, including the GCC area, began to rapidly rise. Today, Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates produce the majority of desalinated water amongst the GCC. In 2022, Saudi Arabia produced 2.9 million cubic meters of fresh water, and the UAE 2.2 million. There are two major desalination categories, thermal and membrane. Virtually all of the mega-sized water fabs of the Gulf Coast operate using thermal-based methods, the dominant being multi-stage flash, or MSF, which first emerged in the 1950s. If you recall, the boiling point of water depends on two things, temperature and surrounding pressure. At sea level, water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. But if you take that pot of water up to 2,000 meters altitude, the boiling point goes down to about 93 degrees Celsius. That is because the atmospheric pressure has gone down. This is MSF's operating principle. Prior to that, large-scale thermal distillation systems evaporated seawater by solely raising the temperature. Practically speaking, this was done by running hot steam through pipes submerged in the seawater. But engineers soon discovered a problem. Over time, a salt layer forms on the pipes' surface, insulating the seawater outside from the heat of the steam inside. This salt formation is referred to as salt scaling, or scaled deposits, and it hurts the evaporation rate enough to necessitate a lengthy cleaning process, sometimes as long as 4 weeks. MSF turns things on its head. We evaporate seawater not only by raising the temperature, but by also lowering the pressure. Here's how the plant works, conceptually. As the name indicates, an MSF plant is made up of many modular stages. Each stage has two sections inside it, a low-pressure flash chamber and a condenser. We send heated seawater into the flash chamber. Inside the flash chamber, the low pressure causes a portion of that water to instantly flash into steam. After exiting the flash chamber, the steam is piped through a demister that removes the pure water vapor. The now saltier liquid brine is moved to the next stage for more flashing. That pure water vapor is then condensed with condenser tubes full of brine or incoming seawater. The vapor releases heat into those tubes and turns into fresh water, which we collect. The heat helps warm up brine or seawater, and this heat recovery and reuse improves the plant's overall efficiency, cutting its power consumption by up to 30 to 35%. Each stage inside the MSF plant has varying levels of pressure and temperatures. The water goes through each stage, flashing off every time. The more stages, the more efficient the plant is. The biggest MSF plants have up to 40 stages and evaporate 85% of the water they take in. The primary design concern with MSF plants is, again, salt scaling. Over time, calcium and magnesium salts precipitate on the heat exchanger tubes and reduce the efficiency of the heat transfer. To prevent this, MSF plant operators do a few things. First, they maintain a top brine temperature of 90 to 120 degrees and also pre-treat the seawater with a decarbonation step to remove dissolved carbon dioxide. Second, they add scale inhibitor chemicals like phosphates to the water. Also commonly used in fracking, these chemicals attach to the nuclei of growing salt crystals, impeding their growth. It works, but is not a panacea, and there are consequences for brine disposal. More on that later. And finally, they do limited washing. Operators can use sponge balls in these square plants to do some cleaning without shutting the whole plant down. They just release a bunch of sponge balls into the water and let them tumble around through the pipes. There is little expectation that the GCC countries will abandon MSF completely in the near future. Why? Because it is simple and can process huge amounts of seawater. These massive MSF plants fit right in the Elon Musk school of industrial thought. No parts are the best parts. There are no moving parts other than conventional water pumps. Furthermore, you have few connecting pipes, which minimizes potential leaks and damage from salt corrosion. So, an MSF plant is far more robust and reliable than its competitors. Many have far outlasted their initial 20-year design lifespan. The MSF plants' stages are also modular, so We can easily add or cut desalination capacity by connecting or disconnecting stages. And finally, pre-treating the water is not super necessary. An MSF plant can take in the worst quality surrounding seawater and eventually turn it into fresh water. What is there not to like? Well, there is one big thing. MSF is massively energy intensive. Estimates vary depending on assumptions, however, I have seen a range of about 10 to 25 kilowatt hours or even higher to produce 1 cubic meter of desalted water. This is taking into account both heat and mechanical energy. Most of the consumed energy is heat, but we need some mechanical energy too to pump the water around. You can try to blunt this burden by pairing the desalination plant with an existing power station and using their byproduct heat energy to preheat the seawater. This cuts energy consumption by about 50% as compared to a single-purpose plant, but even so, the energy requirements can get to daunting sizes. In 2014, Saudi Arabia's cogeneration plants consumed 1.5 million barrels of oil each day, or 15% of its oil production. Things have improved since then, thanks to an ongoing switch from oil to natural gas, but it is likely that without the GCC countries' big energy reserves and generous subsidies, these massive MSF plants would not be economical. Seawater reverse osmosis, or SWRO, is the dominant membrane-based desalination method. In this method, we use pressure to push salty water through a semi-permeable filter. The salt gets caught in the filter, and what comes out the other side is clean water. Since we do not heat up the water, there is no need for thermal energy. This makes it far less energy intensive, about 4 to 5 kilowatt hours per cubic meter of water, which is just a third or even quarter that of MSF. Energy is the single most significant cost factor for water desalination. For this reason, after 2000, every country outside of the GCC when building a desalination plant has largely opted against thermal processes. So, despite the fact that the world's largest desalination plants are MSF plants, MSF itself has less than 20% market share of world installed desalination capacity, reverse osmosis being by far the leader with over 60%. This is in part because of their far lower energy requirements. There are other upsides with SWRO. We can connect it to a cheap and renewable energy source like solar, and since the size threshold for an economical system is far smaller than MSF, it encourages more localized water sources for towns and cities. In other words, no expensive pipelines. The major downside of large-scale reverse osmosis operation is that we need to care a lot more about the seawater going into the system. Silt, algae, jellyfish swarms, salts, and decomposed material or humics can foul up the membranes. So we pre-treat the water before it goes into the RO. We not only run it through screens and sand filters, but also add chlorine or anticoagulants. The nature of the pre-treatment highly depends on the water source location and can add up to 25% to the final cost of the desalted water. Among the GCC countries, Bahrain has the highest usage rate of reverse osmosis because their source water is more brackish. Saudi Arabia built their first ever reverse osmosis plant in the city of Jeddah in 1978, though apparently mostly as a demonstration unit. MSF methods will continue to dominate in this region because billions were spent on these installations and you can't just walk away. But as costs and environmental pressures mount on MSF and other thermal methods, GCC countries like Saudi Arabia have explored more RO-only and hybrid RO thermal systems to incorporate the best of both worlds. In 2022, the Saudi Water and Electricity Company commissioned one of their first ever big reverse osmosis plant, Shukaik 3, on the Red Sea. It has a capacity of 450,000 cubic meters of water per day, making it one of the biggest of its kind and cost $600 million. Saudi Arabia's recent privatization moves in its freshwater supply industry will continue these trends towards more sustainable desalination. I am pretty encouraged. There is one other serious environmental concern that both thermal and membrane processes have to deal with, and we cannot exclude brine. For every 2 cubic meters of fresh water produced, you get 1 cubic meter of brine. So 2.2 million cubic meters of fresh water means having to dispose of 1.1 million cubic meters of brine. After processing, the remaining brine comes out very hot and salty, maybe 40 to 80% saltier than seawater. Oftentimes it has other things in it like heavy metals, acids, chlorine, and the aforementioned anti-scaling chemicals. Brine disposal is challenging. Other than energy, brine disposal is one of the most significant cost factors in desalination, likely adding anywhere between 5 to 30% to the fresh water's final cost. What can you do with the brine? The options are limited. Bury it underground and you foul the groundwater. Dump it at the shoreline or deep underwater and it hurts the local ecosystem, even with substantial seawater or treated wastewater dilution. How about extracting and selling the salt from the brine? Yes, you can do it, but it's not yet economically viable. Salt hasn't been valuable since the 1800s. And what about the other chemicals that were injected into the brine? Environmental issues associated with desalination are a whole different video, but these issues are common to both SWRO and MSF methods and will only get worse as the GCC countries' water demands expand and more desalination megafabs are built to accommodate them. This leads to our concluding issue. The majestic MSF mega water fabs of the Middle East inspire in me awe and wonder, but I also have to admit that they probably should not exist. Not that desalination must be abolished, I've heard such things and find it impractical. We must acknowledge the fact that these countries regularly use 8 to 10 to even 30 plus times the amount of fresh water they have. Desalination must happen and the water must flow. But we also must try to break down the intense centralization of the GCC countries' water systems. 50% of Saudi Arabia's desalination capacity is concentrated in just 5 plants. 60% of the UAE's capacity, just 4 plants. It's not just uneconomical and environmentally dangerous, but also a national security threat. Imagine annihilating half of a country's water supply with 5 quick drone strikes. A technology transition away from MSF towards SWRO could encourage a decentralization trend, bringing water supplies far closer to where people consume them. It's better for the community, the nation, and the world. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.